Hello. Did you know that there are specific tools to facilitate the co-creation process for a climate-resilient urban environment, especially during the planning phase of this process? Today, we will look at one example in detail, the adaptation support tool. In order to design a climate-resilient city, appropriate adaptation measures have to be integrated during the design phase of an urban redevelopment process. However, there are many adaptation measures available. So, how can we become aware of all those adaptation measures? And how can we find the right ones for a specific location? Frans, what can you say about that?
Well, first priority, I think, is to get an overview of the measures you can take. And that is why we made an overview of these potential measures. After having that overview, you can really go to a project area and see what could be done where. So now let me demonstrate some of these potential solutions for specific areas. If you say, well, let's take a simple example of an intensive green roof. Some people will know these solutions, others won't. So having an overview of what that could look like is a first start of a discussion with the audience, experts and non-experts, on what could be selected. And well, as you can see, we see some different pictures of how it could look like and what the effectiveness of a solution could be. Does this fit a specific area? Yes or no? That is up to the stakeholders to decide, standing around this design table, of course. So that is why we are going to use this design table in a public participation session. People will stand around the table, experts, as I said, experts in urban drainage, experts in urban green, environmental scientists, but also representatives of the local population could stand around the table and could see which measures can be chosen where.
So the tool can be used to invite local experts to talk about their specific area and to bring their local knowledge on the table?
And combine that with the knowledge that experts bring to the table, experts on green, on drainage, and so on and so on. So in order to, in the end, come up with a list of solutions, and that list of solutions sufficiently covers the climate resilience challenge for this specific area. The idea is, first of all, to give that overview to the participants, visualize the wide choice of solutions that can be selected. But from that moment on, we can start using these solutions in that specific area and see what the effectiveness and what the effect will be on the hydrology, on the water quality, and in terms of costs. So what we start with is showing the overview of potential measures, the long list, as we call it, of potential measures. This could be up to 70 measures included in here. Fortunately, in this case, we used, I think, about only 40 or 50. But the idea is to, well, first of all, take a look at this long list with the participants, and in order to make them understand what we are talking about. By going through this list and showing pictures of different solutions, they can get an impression on, well, what could be installed where and how could that look like in practice. Is this nicely looking? And how do I like this picture? Can my children play there? These questions pop up in their mind. Well, for us, the climate resilience is important. The storage capacity, the heat stress reduction, and so on. So this way they get an overview of the potential solutions they can select from. After having that overview, they can sort of shortlist these solutions. They can prioritize them for themselves. And from that moment on, they can start implementing these solutions, selecting these solutions, and apply them on specific areas in the, so they could say, okay, let's use in this case, an intensive green roof, and by applying it right here, they have an over. They know. Okay, now this building is covered with a green roof. The only thing the system doesn't know yet is how much depth of water can be stored in that green roof. Is that only 1 centimeter, 10 centimeters, half a meter, whatever? So what we have to do manually is say, okay, I want to have a green roof with a retention capacity of, say, what was an intensive green roof, so maybe 20 centimeters, something like. So from that moment on, we could start saying, well, okay, I want to have a green roof with a depth of 20 centimeters. And by saving this solution, the system adds that to the total storage capacity, to the peak flow reduction, calculates what the impact will be on water quality and so on. So that's how you get this overview of measures and the effectiveness of each measure. You can compare that to target values of the measures.
So this tool then really helps during this conceptual planning phase, so that they can also discuss with each other using the tool
what to be done where. And we see the result of this conceptual planning phase, the map as it is shown here, as an input for the urban landscape architect and for the urban designer to come up with a design that is really attractive. Because, well, it says you could do a water square right here, but it doesn't define how the water square should look like. The detailed design is yet to be made by the landscape architect and the urban planner.
Thank you, Frans, for this introduction to the adaptation support tool and to showing us how it can be used during the conceptual planning phase of an urban redevelopment process, and how such a tool can be used to enrich the dialogue between the different stakeholders that are part of such a process.
You're welcome.
And you? Have you given it a thought which adaptation measures are suitable in your local surroundings?